Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. The incarnated God-man was locked in an ongoing battle with the Pharisees. The Sabbath day was a big event for the Jewish leadership, and they were proud over not doing any work on the seventh day. Jesus wanted to heal people anytime and refused to back down when the Pharisees accused him of violating the Mosaic law. These demon-possessed men were powerless to stop the supernatural work being done, and in their depravity, ironically insisted the miracles of Jesus were actually from the devil. The Son of God responded to this outlandish claim and stated that such a sin would never be forgiven. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm glad to have you here today with us. And we're going to be talking today, one of the subjects is blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And that is a deep subject. So let's just pray right now. My Heavenly Father, thank you for helping me to present this message. Help me, Lord, to hear from you and to speak the words that the Holy Spirit tells me so that I will be your mouthpiece today. Not myself, but I will be speaking for the Lord Jesus Christ. Let the Holy Spirit anoint me, anoint everyone listening and watching. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, I want to give you a background here about Jesus that we are going to look upon now. Think about this. Jesus put a lot of work in to call Abraham. And he was a liar, and Jesus had to put up with it and try to get him to line up. His son Isaac also was a liar, following the father's footstep. Jacob was a manipulator. He was a liar. He was a thief. And before he wrestled with God and had his changed. And then think about having to bring Joseph down to Egypt and elevate him up. Get the family down there, 70 of them, keeping them for 400 years, protecting them, raising up Moses, and then getting them out of Egypt supernaturally. Then had to put up with it for 40 years in the wilderness as they were complaining and complaining and complaining. And then we had Joshua brought them into the land, and again, the people begin to look at different idols left and right. Then we had the time of the judges where they were sin, judged, come back to God, sin, judged, back to God. And then we got the disasters with King Saul, David, and Solomon, kingdom split. Have all these different kings' houses in the north. And finally, it got so bad that God said, okay, I'm going to knock out the 10 northern tribes. And they went into captivity, into Assyria. And then about 100 years later, I'm sure that Jesus was hoping, will Judah turn, Judah and Benjamin? And they did the opposite. So he had to cream them, destroy Jerusalem, temple, back to Babylon, and then brought them back from Babylon. And we had Nehemiah and all the others, and they restored again the worship of God. They had a little temple. And then Jesus came to his own. It says in the Bible. And how do you think Jesus thought about this? The high priest and his group of people simply said, Jesus, no. The Pharisees, we don't like him. Sadducees, we don't like him. Kill him. And the only one that responded to him were people. Can you imagine the frustration of Jesus having invested all that time, all that effort from Abraham on, and he comes back, and the Jewish leadership at that time simply says, we don't accept you. The lesson here today is a running battle. Now, the Pharisees were not really caring about the Sabbath. They were simply picking arguments with Jesus. And they were always bickering. The Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the Levites, always bickering. It is almost like, if I can give you this picture, that you have a guy that's trying to run away, and you got a dog that keeps biting him in the heels. You keep bugging him, and he trying to kick the dog, get the dog out, and the dog just stays with it. Frustration. I want to shoot that dog. That is a frustration that Jesus must have had when he was walking here in Galilee. So we read now from chapter 12 here, verse number 1. At that time, Jesus went on a Sabbath day through the corn, and his disciples were hungered and began to pluck the ears of the corn and to eat. Let me tell you this. This was not American corn that we have today. American corn did not exist in the Middle East at that time. It was native to America. So it was a cornfield. And that's a type of a wheat. You have wheat, barley, corn, and oats. Those are the four grains that you had. So his disciples number walking through that they were hungry. And they were picking off. And they were trying to get the kernels and to get something to eat, to snack on. So it was a Sabbath. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto Jesus, behold, your disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon the Sabbath day. If you're hungry, you can't pick something. You cannot go and pick a tomato or a pear off a tree, because that's work. It is so ridiculous. The Pharisees at that time and the Pharisees at now. Let me just give you this one example. The Jews have what they call a Sabbath light. Sabbath means the Sabbath or Saturday. They are taught this. You cannot flip a switch. If you flip a switch, that's work. You can't do that. So they designed a Sabbath light. It's electric. It's plugged in. And it has a shade that can be twisted. So they sell these lights to Jewish families. And so on the Sabbath, they cannot turn on electricity with switches. But they can do their Sabbath light by twisting it. And now they are keeping the Sabbath. That's how stupid they are. So, what did Jesus say to them? He said to them, have you not read what David did when he was hungry and that they that were with him? How he entered into the house of God and did eat the showbread which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priest. If you turn now with me to keep your fingers here and turn to 1 Samuel, that's 1 Samuel, we're going to read about this. 1 Samuel and chapter 21. Chapter 21. And we're going to read verses 1 through 6. Then came David to Nob, to Ahimelech, the priest. And Abimelech was afraid at the meeting of David and said to him, "Why are you alone and no man with you?" And David said unto Ahimelech, the priest, "The king has commanded me a business, has said unto me, let no man know anything of the business whereabout I sent you and what I've commanded you, and I have appointed my servants to such and such a place." Now he lied. David lied. He was running from Saul. Saul had not commissioned him to go someplace. So when you read the Bible, you find out that some of these heroes, they lied, they cheated, they did all kinds of things. Verse 3 now. "Now therefore, what is under thine hand, give me 5 loaves of bread in my hand of what there is present." And the priest answered David and said, "There is no common bread under my hand, but there is hallowed bread if the young men have kept themselves at least from women." In other words, you could eat that hallowed bread if you had not had sex with your wife, because then you were unclean that day. And David answered the priest and said to him, "Of a truth, women have been kept from us about these 3 days since I came out, and the vessels of the young men are holy, and the bread is in a manner common, yea, through was sanctified this day in the vessel." So the priest gave him hallowed bread, for there was no bread there, but the show bread that was taken from before the Lord, to put hot bread in the day when it was taken away. So Jesus quoted that. Now, he didn't discuss the lying that David did, but he simply said that on the Sabbath, they took out a show bread, which was set aside for the Lord, and they ate that because they had nothing else to eat. Verse number 5, now back in Matthew 12:5. "Well, have you not read in the law how on the Sabbath day the priests of the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless?" Now, where can we read about that? Well, we find that in Numbers chapter 28. So turn to Numbers chapter 28. And we're going to be looking here. If I can flip here. 28. And verses 8 through 10. "And the other lamb shall you offer at even, as a meat offering in the morning, as a drink offering thereof, you shall offer it, a sacrifice made by fire and a sweet savour of the Lord. And on the Sabbath day, 2 lambs of the first year without spot and 2 tenth deals of a flour for a meat offering, mingled with oil and a drink offering thereof." Now the priests had to work on the Sabbath. They simply had to slaughter these animals so they could have a sacrifice. So in other words, what is Jesus trying to say? He's simply saying this. You can do certain things on the Sabbath. Let's read verse number 6 now. Back in Matthew 12. But I say to you that in this place is one greater than the temple. Jesus is not simply saying this. Look, there's someone here greater than the temple. He talked about himself. They didn't understand that. He's a creator. He's God. And he's standing there. But if you had known what this means, I will have mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath day. Does that mean that Jesus had voided out the commandment that we should not do any work on the Sabbath day? No. But there are certain things that you have to do that are natural. You have to go to the bathroom. You have to eat. You have to cook. There are certain things you have to do. And Jesus simply said this, I am the Lord of the Sabbath. I can do good on the Sabbath if I want to. And he wanted to. Verse number 9. And when he was departed thence, he went into the synagogue. Now, going into a synagogue is going into a den of thieves and demons. And behold, there was a man which had his head withered. And they asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath days that they might accuse him? I want you to think now, how irritated Jesus must have been. Here are these Pharisees, Sadducees, Levites, nitpicking. And Jesus is doing good. They reject him as the Messiah. And all they want to do is to slow him down and give him a bad time. And then Jesus answered and said in verse 11, what man shall it be among you that shall have one sheep, and it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day? Will he not lay hold on it and lift it out? He must have simply not said, okay, you know, if you have a Sabbath day, can't you do this? I'm sure he was a said, you know. Who among you would be stupid enough, you have your sheep fall into a pit. And you simply say, well, it's a Sabbath day, so I can't pick it up. I got to wait for 12 hours. No, you will pick it up. And then Jesus said, how much then is a man better than a sheep? Wherefore, it is lawful to do well on the Sabbath day. Sunday is my Sabbath. I'm working on Sundays. I'm preaching on Sundays. I pray for the sick on Sundays. But I'm not out and doing any physical work. I'm not painting my house. I'm not out digging in the yard. But we can do good. You came to church today. Do you know that a Jew today has to live very close to a synagogue? Here in Sacramento, they live in a certain area, and they have put markers 3 or 4 blocks, so there's an area blocked off that is inside the allowed distance that the Jew can go to the synagogue on the Sabbath. If he's outside that boundary, he can't go to the synagogue on the Sabbath. Now, a woman that has children and she has them in a baby carriage cannot go to the Sabbath, cannot go to the synagogue because that's work to pushing the cart, the carriage. So a Jewish woman has to stay home because she can't work on Saturday. Saturday is a Sabbath. So they still have all these different laws amounted to nothing. And they nitpick or not. Picture Jesus now in a synagogue. He saw those Pharisees, their hats on and everything else, you know, and look like this. And he looked at the man and said to him, "Stretch forth your hand." The man was withered. He stretched it forth, and suddenly he was healed. Jesus never touched him. It was done supernaturally. And the man was well. You would think the man was happy. Praise God, I got my hand back. You know, it's good to have two hands. Now, verse number 14. Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him. How blessed these guys were. They went out to the synagogue and had a board meeting, saying, how are we going to be able to kill Jesus? Because he's not conforming to our rules, laws, and standard. That's how the devil is. That's what woke is. You're not conforming. Well, we've got to cancel you. You can't do that. You have to conform. It's a big battle right now in our school system. Where parents are saying we don't want our children to sit in school when they read about, but they have book, sexual explicit description of having sex. And the law says that you can't take your children out. You cannot do that. It's warped. And parents today are saying this: we will not comply. This is what we got to do as Christians. When they ask us to sin, it is our duty to say, we will not comply. When Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all. And charged them that they should not make him known. And then he quoted the prophet Isaiah. So let's read that from verse number 17. Jesus said this. He quoted now Isaiah, that it might be fulfilled which is spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, "Behold my servant, whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom my soul is well pleased. I have put my spirit upon him. He shall show judgment to the Gentiles. He shall not strive nor cry, neither shall any man hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed shall he not break, and a smoky flax shall he not quench, till he sends forth judgment unto victory, and in his name shall the Gentiles trust." Jesus eventually will have a day of judgment. But until that day, the evil are allowed to live among us. The tares and the wheat. we can push back. We can talk to a tear. We can talk to an unsaved person. And the Holy Spirit can convict them. They can get saved. Every one of us were tares before we got born again. And so we should remember this. We can pray. We can testify. We can witness. And we can do leading people to Christ. Verse number 22. There was brought unto him one possessed with a devil, blind and dumb, and he healed him, insomuch that the blind and the dumb both spake and saw. Can you imagine this? You lose your eyesight. That's bad. But you also lose your ability to talk. How do you communicate? You can't see. You can't talk. You're stuck. And Jesus saw this man, and he removed the spirits that made him dumb, and the spirit that made him blind, and he healed. Verse 23, and all the people were amazed and said, is not this the son of David? They saw that, they realized this has to be the power of God. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow does not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. They changed tactics now. They realized this guy that couldn't speak, he was blind. He can see, he can talk. Obviously, that is a miracle. But they now changed tactics and said, this miracle was done by the power of Beelzebub. Ascribing the work of God to the devil. And Jesus knew that thought. Now Jesus can read the minds of people. And said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. And every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if Satan cannot Satan, he is divided against himself, how shall then his kingdom stand? And if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore, they shall be your judge. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Jesus now told them this. There's no way that Satan cast out Satan. He fights himself. I use the power of God. In verse 29 he said, or else how can one enter the strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. That verse, number 29, is a verse that we should use as a Christians. Because I told this to a businessman that we had in the ministry. If you want to do business, and the other people might not be saved, they have company here, company there, whatever, you have to take dominion. That business that you want to work with is controlled by a demon. They're under Satan's kingdom. And when you come up and you knock on a door and you give them a proposal and so on, that demon is not going to say, oh, that's nice. He's going to give you problems. He's going to say, no, we're not going to have you. If you want to do business with unbelievers, you have to bind the strong man. You bind up the demon over that business, you can walk in. And now God can work through the Holy Spirit. This goes for if you go to a hospital, if you go to pray for some people, bind up the strong man. Don't just walk in. Bind up the strong man. And then Jesus said, he that is not with me is against me. He that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. There's a lot of religions today. Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, and others, Roman Catholic Church. And they are scattering. They're not working with Jesus. And then verse number 31. Wherefore I send to you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven of the men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. What does verse number 31 mean? It simply means this. If you are in a place, in the church, you are at some place, in a meeting, or in a home, whatever it is, and somebody, in the name of Jesus, have somebody healed, or something great happen, and then you says, that's not of God, that's of the devil. You just blasphemed the Holy Spirit. We have to be very careful when we see healings or manifestations, because there are certain things of the devil. The devil can heal. He heals in this way. Sickness is of him and the demons. He just withdraw, and then the person is healed. But he cannot heal. He can go away, and people get healed. Verse number 32. And whosoever speaks a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaks against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Now that's pretty harsh, that it cannot be forgiven. Let me read that again. And whosoever speaks a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaks against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Notice now, he doesn't say you lose your salvation. He said it will not be forgiven him. How is that going to work? Turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. That is 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And we're going to pick it up in verse 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 8. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every man, that every one may receive the things done in his body, according to what he has done, whether it be good or bad. That judgment seat is in heaven. That's where you go after your body dies on this earth. If you are born again, that's where you go, to the judgment seat of Christ. If you have blasphemed the Holy Spirit, It will not be forgiven you. It will cost you. It will be a mark on you. You will simply lose certain things. It will not be forgiven you. And so we really want to be careful when we see things happening. It is better to simply say this: I don't know if there is a healing, if there's a miracle, whatever it is. It is better to simply say this: I don't know how it was done. I'm not going to step in. That's safe. Back to Matthew chapter 12 now. And then, and whosoever speaks a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaks against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. There are certain things on this earth that are set in stones. For example, if you messed up in your youth and you didn't finish high school, and you didn't go to college or anything like that, you can compensate. You can get not a degree, but you can get simply compensate and get a high school diploma by studying. And you can take classes later on. But the years you have missed, you cannot go back. If you had an abortion, God will forgive you. But you can't bring the baby back. You will be forgiven. If you kill somebody, murder somebody, the Apostle Paul did that. He was forgiven. But the person that died would not come back. There are two ways you can lose your salvation. Matter of fact, at first I want to go to Revelation chapter 20. So Revelation chapter 20. And this is a scripture we have read many times. Revelation chapter 20. And verse number 11. And I saw a great white throne, him that sat on it, from his face the earth and the heavens fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. The books were open, another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of the things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. At the end of this world, after the 1,000-year kingdom, every person who has died from the time of Adam and Eve and up to that time will be resurrected. We're talking now about the unsaved people. They will be resurrected with a body of shame. They will come out of hell, whatever, and they're going to stand in front of the great white throne. If their names are not in the book of life, if they have not repented of their sins and been born again, they cannot go to heaven. They will be condemned to the lake of fire. So the people that are around you says, well, I'm a good man, I'm a Roman Catholic, I'm this, I'm that, you know, and so on. On that day, they're going to go to hell. So as Christians, if we believe this, you would pray for the people in your family. You will witness to the people. You will do everything you can to simply say, you have to be born again. You don't want to go to the lake of fire, do you? Do you want to go there? We got to persuade them and witness to them. So it's going to be a terrible time. The majority, 90% or more of the population that ever lived on the earth is not saved. They didn't get saved when they lived. And they will go to the lake of fire and realizing it's over. Can you lose your salvation? Yes. There are two ways you can lose your salvation. The first one is found in Revelation 14. Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11. And the third angel followed and sang with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast, his image, and receive his mark in his forehead with his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of the torment ascends up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night. And they have no rest day or night who worship the beast and his image and whosoever receives the mark of his name. We're coming up to that time in the future. And remember this, you might be born today, born again today, you're a Christian today. The pressure will be so hard on you when the Antichrist is here that you will simply say, well, I got to feed my children. I got to have food. I got to comply. Remember this, you comply and you just lost your salvation. You can never repent. You take the mark of the beast, and you can never come back and say, oh God, I shouldn't have taken the mark of the beast. I'm so sorry. And Jesus is going to say, too bad. You're done. You betrayed me. Everyone that took they cannot undo it. A lot of people today are dropping dead. Heart attacks. Young people. Suddenly. And the people that took they can't undo it. They cannot say, well, God, can you heal me from I'm not saying if God can or not. Well, if he will. But you took it. You are stuck. I want to drill that in. Whatever you do, it's better to die to take the and take the second one is in Revelation chapter 22. How you lose your salvation. That's Revelation chapter 22, verse number 19. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. Any person that walks around and says, well, this might be in the Bible, but it is not in the Bible. It's wrong. We take it away. Jehovah's Witnesses, they have removed a number of Bible verses. The same thing with Mormons. They have removed a lot of Bible verses. They're not going to go to heaven. They're going to go to hell, lay the lake of fire. Be careful when you talk to people. If you do not agree with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and you do not agree with the gift of the Holy Spirit, don't say to people, that's not for today. We have the Bible now. We don't have miracles today. You just took away things out of the Bible. Don't mess with the Word of God. Leave it as is. And you tell people this, if God said it, it settles it, I believe it. The Bible as the King James Version. The people that produced and edited the NIV and all the other Bibles they have, they have removed hundreds, if not thousands, of verses. They have simply removed. They don't know that they've removed themselves from salvation. These men and women that pushed that are simply removing things from the Word of God. Let me read that verse again. Verse 19. Revelation 22. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out of the holy city, and for the things which are written in this book. Can you ask for forgiveness if you by stupidity rejected the Holy Spirit? I believe you can. I was trained in the Southern Baptist Church that the gifts were not for us today. I didn't teach it. I simply thought, okay, that's what they say. Until I was introduced to the Holy Spirit. I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. But there are some people, there are some hardcore Baptists and other denominations that would simply say, no, the Holy Spirit is not here today like he was in the book of Acts. No, we don't speak in tongues. No, there's no healing. No, we don't cast out demons. That guy has just sentenced himself to the lake of fire. This might not be the nicest sermon I've preached, but we need to know what we can do, what we cannot do, and how things work in the spirit world. So we had a warning from Jesus. If you talk blasphemy of the Spirit, it will not be forgiven you. If you talk bad about me, we forgive you for that. But don't mess with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Don't take the mark of the beast. And don't say this is not in the Bible, as we have in the King James Bible. Those are the three things that you want to make sure that you do not do. Either of ignorance or stupidity. Or both. Well, I'm going to close this message there. And some people have been listening to me that are not saved. And you're saying that you're a pretty hard preacher. Well, I am, because I love you. I love people so much that I would tell them the truth. I'm not going to sugarcoat it and simply so that you feel good, and then you end up in a lake of fire. That would be bad. I'd rather push you. I'd rather kick you around, make you uncomfortable, so that they will drive you to Jesus. And here's how would you do if you're not saved. You simply confess, I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. I believe that God is. I believe that Jesus is God's Son. I believe that Jesus died on the cross. I believe that he rose from the dead. I believe that Jesus paid for my sins. God, forgive me my sins. Jesus, come into my life right now and save me. I want to be born again. And he will do that. When we finish here, the screen on your would change. Three crosses will come up. And you will hear the voice of Pastor Charles saying, my friend. And he will spend 10 minutes with you, showing you more scriptures, praying with you, and helping you to make sure you're saved today. And when you do that today, would you contact us? Go to our website and let me know that I got saved today. Now, to the believers in Christ, those of you that are walking with Christ, what should you take home with you from today? This is what I want to take home. Go through this sermon again. Read it very slowly. And then ask God, have I done something like this? And if you find out that there have been times where you says, well, you had a bastard Bible and it was taken away, so you gave an answer to people that was not fully correct, ask God to forgive you. Whatever you've done, ask God to forgive you. And then from now on, be a stickler. And simply says, every word that I find in the King James Version, I believe is inspired by God's Holy Spirit. I'm not going to remove and say, well, we can skip this, we can skip that. No. We don't skip anything. If the word says it, it's going to be applied, and we obey. Ask God to show you where you are. Ask God to give you compassion for people that are lost. And then simply say, every day, Jesus, let me share with someone today the gospel. You might not be a preacher, but you can tell people your testimony. You can say, I have accepted Christ. Jesus came in and saved me. I've repented of my sins. I'm a Christian. And God loves you, and he wants you to do the same thing. No one can knock your testimony. May God bless you as you ponder on this and really pray and think about this afternoon and the rest of the week. Here's Thomas.
Father God, we thank you for the Word of God. We thank you for knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Help us to continue to dig into the Word daily. And we thank you for our personal revelation as we read and study the Word. And we ask your blessing upon everybody that took time today to go to church, to tune in, and we are blessed. We thank you for so great a salvation, never to be taken for granted. Salvation is huge. We thank you for it. We thank you for taking us through, Lord. We know that perilous times are coming, and that only those that are firmly planted will be able to persevere. So we thank you for your strength to persevere and to walk in the light. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5, 7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send his Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, he will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, he will do for you. If you call out to him, he will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says, "Today is the day of salvation." Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and he has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 31st part in the series, The Gospel of Matthew, and was entitled, Blaspheming the Holy Spirit. The incarnated God-man was locked in an ongoing battle with the Pharisees. The Sabbath day was a big event for the Jewish leadership, and they were proud over not doing any work on the seventh day. Jesus wanted to heal people 7 days a week and refused to back down when the Pharisees accused him of violating the Mosaic law. The Pharisees were powerless to stop the supernatural work being done. Any healing should bring joy to the people watching, but in their depravity, these demon-possessed men ironically insisted the miracles of Jesus were actually from the devil. The Son of God responded to this outlandish claim and laid into the Pharisees for ascribing the work of the Holy Spirit to Beelzebub. Speaking ill of Jesus can be forgiven, but if you speak against the Holy Spirit in such a manner, that transgression will carry forward into eternity. Don't be that person. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1928. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.